first, and then we can pray and ask the Lord to bless. It's coming out of the book of Colossians, chapter 2, verses 12 and 13, and speaks on the resurrection and the fact that you belong to the Lord. You are actually raised together with him. It says in verse 12, buried with him in baptism, which you were also raised with him through faith in the working of God, who raised him from the dead. And verse 13 says, and you, being dead in your trespasses and the uncircumcision of your flesh, he is made alive together with him, having forgiven you all trespasses, having wiped out the handwriting of requirements that was against us and was contrary to us. He has taken it out of the way, having nailed it to the cross, having disarmed principalities and powers, and made a public spectacle of them, triumphing over them in it. So let's pray. Heavenly Father, as we think about these words, there's a lot of information there, and even about baptism. We're not saved by baptism. It's just used to describe an event and the belief by the believer. But we do know, it's literally true, that when he died on the cross, he disarmed the one who has power over non-believers, even the enemy. But he doesn't have power over us now, because your son rose from the dead.
Yes.
And now we can have the Holy Spirit in us, because you could see us as being sinless, because your son paid the debt, and yet we do sin. But your word tells us, if we walk in the light as he is in the light, we have fellowship with God and the blood. We have fellowship with Jesus Christ, and the blood of Jesus Christ cleanses us from all sin. And we know, Lord, we have trouble walking sometimes, a lot of times, but you promise that you clean us as we come to you for forgiveness.
Thank you, Lord.
We thank you that we're eternally part of your family and your household, that we are the living stones which your son's body lives in here on earth, with him as our head in heaven. We ask today that you will bless us, to help us to learn more about this resurrection and the life that is now in us, because it's the life of your own precious son whom we're accepted in. We thank you in Jesus' name. Amen.
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 There's a lot of different belief systems in there, in the world out there, and there's a tendency to spiritualize a lot of things, even within the body of Christ, the true believers. But there's so much information in Scripture. We can corroborate, we can validate, we can verify that it's true, what we read. We don't have to worry if there's something we don't understand. The Lord said in John 7 and verse 17, if any man wants to know the doctrine concerning me, if it's true, in other words, what the Lord was saying, he said, if he's willing to do it, I'll show him. So I'm just going to read that verse for us, because it tells us how to approach the Lord and his word. In verse 16 and 17, it says, Jesus, of John 7, it says, Jesus answered them and said, my doctrine is not mine, but his who sent me. Verse 17, if anyone wills to do his will, he shall know concerning the doctrine, whether it is from God or whether I speak on my own authority. Now, if you just read that, you might say, my doctrine is not mine. That means Jesus is lower than God. But read the next verse. He who speaks from himself seeks his own glory, but he who seeks the glory of the one who sent him is true, and no unrighteousness is in him. So the Lord Jesus is making it plain that he was sent. If you look in the book of John, the word sent occurs over 70 times. When Jesus refers to his mission, he's often giving us the context by saying, him who sent me. John 3, verse 13 gives us another example. No one has ascended to heaven, but he who came down from heaven, that is the Son of Man who is in heaven. He had just told them, if I tell you earthly things and you do not believe, how will you believe if I tell you heavenly things? Nicodemus was being spoken to as a teacher of Israel. He had God's word, and he studied God's word, and he memorized God's word. Can you imagine? To be a Pharisee, you had to study God's word and know the whole thing by heart. So Nicodemus came before the Lord asking more about how he can get right with God. And the Lord said, you must be born again. John 3, verse 3, Jesus says, most assuredly, I say to you, unless one is born again, you cannot see the kingdom of God. So you have to look at the context before we arrive at a conclusion. And one thing about God's word is that it's absolute. If you break it, it still applies. If you bend it, that's nullifying and voiding God's word. See, the one thing about the Lord is that he's loving, but he's also holy. And thankfully, he's merciful, because he can still be merciful at no expense to being holy. And he could be just at no expense to be merciful. So he made another way. When it says in the scripture that the soul that sins shall die, which is every person ever born, he also said that the gift of God is eternal life in Christ Jesus. So he can provide a gift and a substitute way of satisfying the sin debt, which is what we're here today about. He made that way in his Son. It was always purposed that the Father would send the Son, and he would have a special ministry, and it would be to come as a man, not a spirit being, but a man. Not there's a word for a spirit being, I forget it. It'll come to me later, I hope. I'm not getting younger. But take a pause. A little break. The point is, Jesus came in the flesh. And because he came in the flesh, people will say, how can that be? How can he be God? And the answer is that God did a miracle. He made man in his image and likeness. It says in Genesis 1, let's make man in our image and likeness. In our image and likeness we shall create him. And then he went and did it with Adam. But Adam sinned. So is that going to end God's plan? I mean, right out of the gate, there's the failure of the one created to be the image and likeness of God. But what did God do? We know what he did. He made his own son a body. Hebrews 10 tells us that the body that was prepared for me from before, it was ever in God's purpose and plan to prepare a body for his son. And when we read a verse that says the only begotten Son of God, here is where you have to use that the regular old common sense thinking. My mom taught me to know the truth. And the Bible says, buy the truth. It comes at a cost. You have to be willing to sacrifice your own preconception and say, Lord, you have to show me because I don't know. And he'll use his word to do that. And you can't be impatient, because you'll arrive at the wrong conclusion. Sometimes we don't find out things that we want to find out. But when the Lord made a body, and I say L, capital O, capital R, capital D, made a body for the Lord, capital L-O-R-D, which is his son, and there's two Lords in Scripture. One is God, that's the one we see with all capitals, and then there's the one with the capital L, and that's his son. So where do we find application for the only begotten? And I offer that it's on the first page of Scripture. It's been stated that the Bible was written for a 10-year-old to understand. So how could that be? Paul said some things are hard to understand. Well, some things, yes. Not all things. Some, which is less than a lot. Some. Most of it you can understand. But we don't know enough about all the details and all the information to make it fit seamlessly, so we can make a wrong assumption, right? We can even call it doctrine. But the point is, when he says, you are my son, today I have begotten you, I remember reading Genesis. 10 times that word begotten, not begotten, according to its own kind, 10 times that occurs before the description of man. It says that God created all the creation on earth, the tree across the street, the birds in the air, the fish in the sea, the cattle, with seed in itself, according to its own kind. Common sense, normal reasoning will tell you it's, a cow's gonna have a cow when it has a baby. A rose is gonna have a rose when it reproduces. It's got its seed in itself, according to its own kind. When he made man, he said, this one begat that one, and that one begat that one, and that one begat that one. And you can see that 10 times on the side of Abel. Abel was killed by Cain, but he had another brother born named Seth. So Eve begot Seth, and Seth begat the one after him, and they begat the one after them. And that word begat occurs 10 times, just like the phrase according to its seed in itself, according to its own kind, also occurs 10 times. So when I hear your only begotten son, only, that tells me it comes from somewhere, not around here. Because there's lots of sons born. So where is only coming from? And it says, my, right? My son. That's where the only comes from. God, does that mean he was born? No. The Lord said, I am he who lives, who was, and is forevermore after he was crucified. In Revelation, right? I am he who lives, and was, and is forevermore. He lives in the power of an endless life. So these are some little things to help. I have to give honor to my mom, you know. She's here, and we only have a limited time on this planet, in this world, in this life. And I remember my mom teaching me some things. We had a neighbor who was a Jewish lady, and she was very kind. And she'd give me little chores and errands to do when I was like 5. And she always wanted to reward me with a nickel. My mom said, your reward's in heaven. And I wanted the nickel. I didn't want to hear about a reward in heaven. And I was successful in saying, okay, the reward's in heaven, until she offered me a dime. And that was it. I said, I knew I shouldn't have taken it because my mom told me not to. I'm sorry, Mom. I even told you when I did it. And you said, it's okay. It was like, I wanted that dime. The temptation was too much. But you know what? There's one person, one man that was born, only one. And he was born not of another man. It says in the Bible, he was born of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
No one else was born of the Holy Spirit. God the Father, God the Son, God the Holy Spirit created Adam from the dust of the earth and then took a rib and created Eve. And they were breathed to life by God. But the Lord Jesus, you know, the Bible is progressively revealing the Son of God. And you see the activities of the persons in the Godhead. You see three persons, three characters, not an idea or a concept, real persons that together are one and they are God, but each one is God. Now, Christianity has been accused of being a multi-God religion, but it's not. Every single thing that happens with full agreement and participation of the Godhead, the Trinity. The Father, the Son, the Holy Spirit. It says in the Bible that God raised up Jesus. The Lord Jesus said, I have power to lay my life down and I have power to raise it up. In Romans 8, chapter 8, verse 11, I believe, it says that we are raised in the power of the Holy Spirit. By the same power that raised him. Wow. That's the Holy Spirit. You know, the Lord Lord said about the Holy Spirit, who, by the way, is the one that God accomplished all the mighty work in creation through, the Son delegating the power of the Spirit. Why doesn't the Son just do it? He's God. It says in John 16:13, and I'm going to read it, the Lord is telling us very important information about how the Trinity works within itself. And you see that the Lord Jesus Christ makes it so perfectly clear there is submission, there is cooperation, there is a working together. In John 16:13, however, when he, that would be the promised Holy Spirit, when he, the Spirit of truth, has come, he will guide you into all truth. For he will not speak on his own authority, but whatever he hears, he will speak, for he will tell you things to come. He will glorify me, for he will take of what's mine and declare it to you. Verse 15, all things that the Father has are mine. What son can say that? In reality, maybe a single son, no other siblings, could say that if he knew the Father would leave him everything in the will, with nothing for anybody else. That means no nephews, no grandchildren, no uncles, no aunts, no charities, nothing. Just all goes to one son. When do you see that in creation? You see it in the Godhead. The Lord Jesus says, all things the Father has are mine, therefore I said that he will take of mine and declare it to you. He will not speak on his own authority. Why not? Why won't the Holy Spirit speak on his own authority? Because his function, his office, is to glorify Jesus, as we just read. So when my mom told me, your reward is in heaven, she got me thinking about those things, heaven. And I said, oh, okay. My mom used to tell me to know the truth, you know. And it made me place a high value on truth. What is truth, you know? Even Jesus was asked that by Pilate. What is truth? It's a very precious thing. Philippians 3:10 says, that I may know him and the power of his resurrection. Is his life really in me, the power that rose Jesus from the dead? Well, if this is God's word, and God can lie, then maybe not. But because God cannot lie, and this is his own word, the power of Jesus Christ empowers me as a believer. And I have fellowship with him when I suffer for his name. It says, and the fellowship of his sufferings being conformed to his death. What's that mean? Well, the Lord said, I always do my Father's will. For this reason, he has not left me alone. Not only will I have power, I will be able to experience the presence and comfort of God if I'm obeying. If I obey God, I will have a likeness to his Son. You know, Colossians 3:10 says that you're renewed in knowledge according to the image of him who created you. And there's only one person that doesn't need, well, there's only one person that his whole body is the image and likeness of God and has the fullness of God in it, and that's the Lord Jesus Christ. But when we get born again, he gives us knowledge about who he is. And his way is the way of love, lowliness. His way is the way of love, true love, which doesn't compromise truth and serves others, being conformed to this, to his death. So when he died on the cross, I have to say, boy, he really loved me a lot. I want to obey him. And he even said, that's what love is. If you love me, you will obey me. Isn't that something? That
Amen.
Our feelings are in line with truth. If you love me, you'll obey me. What a motivator to obey him. The fact that he died for me. It says in 2 Corinthians 13, verse 4, for though he was crucified in weakness, the whole world thought he was weak. They said, come down, if you're the Son of God. Yet he lives by the power of God. Paul was told in the same book, but the chapter earlier, in chapter 12, verse 9, my grace is sufficient for you, for my strength is made perfect in weakness. And that won't be present when I get resurrected. Neither will it be for any believer. See, the Lord's the only one ever on this earth, the only human being that never used his flesh for the wrong thing. He always glorified God. Colossians 3 says, "For you died, and your life is hid with Christ in God." And Philippians 3:21 says that he will transform our bodies and make us have a body like unto his. It says in chapter 3 and verse 4, "When Christ, who is our life, appears, then you will also appear with him in glory." Wow. That all depends on the resurrection. All of this. But you know, the reason he rose, very simple, he was an acceptable sacrifice. Hebrews 10:10 says, "By that will we have been sanctified through the offering of the body of Jesus Christ once for all." So this is a literal statement. A man used his body, who was also God, to pay for the sins of man, but he was also a qualified sacrifice because he never sinned or he'd never be able to make the offering. He said in verse 5, in chapter 10, "Therefore, when he came into the world, he said, 'Sacrifice and offering you did not desire, but a body you have prepared for me.'" It's wonderful to come to the Lord when you sin and say, "Please forgive me," because he cleanses us and washes us from all sin by his Son's blood. That cleansing is so important because we know we're clean and we don't give up. And we have hope again. We're restored to fellowship. The relationship is never broken because it's not created by us. It's created by God. But the fellowship, that depends on us. And the fact that the Lord offered himself and then was raised proves that he never sinned. Not only did he not sin, but his body did not see corruption. And in Psalm 16, in verse 10, it says, "My body will not see corruption," speaking of the Lord Jesus Christ. And I love the rest of that verse where it says, that chapter, only two more verses, where it says, "You will show me the paths of life. In your presence is fullness of joy, and at your right hand are pleasures forevermore." The Bible says that the Lord literally ascended to heaven and sat at the right hand of God. If I die and my life is hid in Christ with God, where am I? Spiritually, not figuratively, spiritually, positionally. Positionally is the correct word. Spiritually applies heaven and earth, because it says in Ephesians 1, "Blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, who has blessed us with every spiritual blessing in the heavenlies in Christ Jesus." But Jesus said on earth, "If I go, I will come again to receive you to myself. Don't be disappointed, I'll send another," capital A, "the Holy Spirit, the Spirit of truth, who will bring all things to your remembrance. He will guide you, he will comfort you, and therein lies my hope, because the Lord put the Holy Spirit in me, and he took me and put me with the Holy Spirit in his Son, Christ, and then he went to heaven and sat at the right hand of God. And I got my flesh right now is like goosebumps from head to toe, just thinking about that. Amen. But I'm living here right now. What do I do? I appropriate that truth because it's the truth. You have to buy it. It costs you something. The salvation doesn't. Having and getting the Holy Spirit in me doesn't. Because we're saved through grace by faith, right? It's all God's grace. You know, there was a reformation that took place in 1500s, Martin Luther was studying God's word as a religious person. And he discovered that resurrection is not only an event, it's really a person. Because Jesus said, "I am the resurrection and the life." And he started looking at grace, and he realized everything fits. He still had a number of wrong beliefs in his theology. However, one thing he got right, and it was enough to overturn the world and start what's called the Reformation, he knew we're not saved by works. that the Holy Spirit used to reintroduce the truth of grace. For by grace you're saved through faith, not of works, lest any man boast. It's the gift of God. Job knew he would be resurrected. They say Job was around before Moses. So if we got the Bible through Moses recording what the Spirit led him to write about 1450, or say 1500 BC, just to round it off, and Job was before him, the book of Job predates Moses historically. And how did Job know to say that he would see his Redeemer in the flesh? In Job chapter 19 and verse 25, he says, I know I will see my Redeemer in the flesh. Wow. Now after Moses, like 500 years later, in the year 1000 BC, did I say AD before? 1500 BC was Moses. Job was before that. David was after Moses, 1000 BC, right, or 950 BC. David said, my son, who had just died, 8-year-old infant, my son will not come to me, but I will go to him. How? He's dead. He knew that of such is the kingdom of God, little children, that child will go right to heaven. David knew. How did David know? David just killed someone to get the wife that birthed the child. How? Because he knew the promises of God are sure. He knew that by faith, appropriated righteousness he didn't work for. He knew that the law, which by the way, given to Israel, the first couple of kings, Solomon and David, they followed the law, you know, they read the law in public, and when David let all the people put the building materials together for the temple, and his son Solomon built it, and they had the opening day, and they read from the words of the law, and they observed the Sabbath, and they didn't plant every 7 years. They let the land have a Sabbath, right? That was it until like 620 BC when they finally found the law again and opened it up and read it. Josiah found it, the boy king, and he said, wow, what have we been doing all this time? Going by memory, going by what we think, by liturgy, reciting things over and over, what we believe. And sure enough, the law of God was absent. They didn't observe any Sabbaths, they didn't observe any joyous feasts of Jehovah, where 7 times a year the Jews would come out and have feasts corresponding to the planting seasons and what was happening in creation, and showing a picture of what was to come, with Passover being the first and really integral one that we can show the blood. The blood is the way that you avoid death. The blood of the Lamb. That's what happens with Passover. But David knew. David knew that he would see his eight-day-old son again. Why? Because of the law. The law said, the soul that sinneth shall die. Bring your offering. Take the blood. Put it on the altar. Bring it into the Holy of Holies. Oh, there's so much picture in there and so much type that directly is fulfilled in black and white print in the New Testament. You can see all the things that the law stipulated, how the priest had to clean the wicks of the candle every day. He cleaned the soot off when he lit the candle, when he cleaned the wicks of the candle and kept the oil, which pictures the Holy Spirit, filled up so it never went out. I mean, there's so much beautiful truth in there. That is picture and type, and that is something in Scripture, picture and type. But you know, the Holy Spirit can only fill us when we empty ourselves. You know, David said, my cup runneth over, right? But he also said, after he committed that murder, he said, restore to me. Do not take your Holy Spirit from me. You know, revive me. He said, a broken and contrite heart I will not despise, O Lord. So that's how you got right with God back then. And yet, it's got a broken vessel, because there's so much of God's Holy Spirit. You put it in there, it'll overflow, even with the brokenness. But that's the only way it's going to overflow, is if we're broken. If we are weak, then we are strong, as Paul said. Because we're not weak spiritually, then we're weak of our own will and our own devices. Death to self is first, and the resurrection power of Christ is able to come through us. And I just want to read from Philippians. It says in Philippians chapter 3, Paul aspired to have this life of Christ in him. He wanted to have the resurrection power, the only power whereby we are alive spiritually on earth. He said, that I may know him and the power of his resurrection and the fellowship of his sufferings, being conformed to his death. Right? So he was talking about sacrificing his own will and passions and bringing them into subjection to the Word of God. Oops. So in order for someone to be resurrected, they first have to die, right? And every Lord's Day we come out and we remember the Lord's death and we give thanks to God and worship, and every heart is able to be received by God in worship as we ponder the beauties of his Son, what he did to lead up to Calvary's cross. And that's a beautiful bookend to today, you know, Easter, Resurrection Sunday, because first he had to die. So the fact that he really did die is a historical fact. There's no less than 5 secular authors from back then who have writings on it that say that he rose, and it was common knowledge that he rose. And if you think about all the apostles and the disciples and followers of him who were martyred because of it, all they had to do was say, okay, I don't believe it. They didn't rise, and they would have been spared. They still went to their death for that. So he was actually testified in that manner. In the book of Acts, every time there's preaching, the topic of resurrection is central, and you see a resistance forming in the audience over resurrection. Remember Stephen? He was the first martyr. He went into, I forget where he was. If anybody remembers, it's Acts chapter 6. No, I'm just going to open to it because we don't have much time. There was one thing that was very interesting, and I only noticed this recently. I did notice that all of the times there was public preaching, even all the way to the end of the book of Acts, which spans decades, even at the end, Paul was able to bring up the issue of resurrection to stop like a riot from happening and a quick judgment on him, right? He said, some of you speak of the resurrection, and we know it's true. And half the audience or so were Sadducees who didn't believe in the resurrection, so they started arguing with the other half, and then Paul was able to, you know, not escape, but get away without getting beaten again. But the point is, he used resurrection to upset the whole room that was accusing him of things and that weren't true. But in Acts chapter 6, Stephen, very interestingly, he gives a very good history of Israel and what God did. In Acts chapter 6, it says in verse 7, after the first deacons and were appointed or pointed out, because they were full of the Holy Spirit, they were pointed out. Verse 7 says, then the word of God spread, and the number of disciples multiplied greatly in Jerusalem, and the great many of the priests were obedient to the faith. Verse 8, and Stephen, full of faith and power, did great signs and signs among the people. Scripture says that to be an apostle, you had to be a witness of his resurrection. You had to be with him from the beginning. Paul was the only one that wasn't like that, although he did see the risen Lord, and it blinded him. And then he saw him again later when he was brought to heaven, next in 1 Corinthians 11. So So Paul did see the risen Savior, but he wasn't there from the beginning. But what he was doing was persecuting the church. So he heard of the wonderful works and the infallible proofs that Acts speaks of. But Stephen, when he did these great wonders and signs, experienced opposition. And it says, Stephen, full of faith and power, did great wonders and signs among the people. Then there arose some from what is called the synagogue of the freedmen, Cyrenians, Alexandrians, and those from Cilicia and Asia, disputing with Stephen, and they were not able to resist the wisdom and the spirit by which he spoke. What happens when someone resists us? Do we say, okay, another day? Sometimes, maybe, if we're smart. But usually we don't. You begin. And that's what they did. That's the normal thing for the flesh. They secretly induced men to say lies. We have heard him speak blasphemous words against Moses and God. And they stirred up the people and elders and scribes, and they came upon him, seized him, and brought him to the council. They also set up false witnesses. I mean, what else? You know? Same thing they did with Paul, with the Lord. So they set this big opposition in motion. And when the high priest in chapter 7, verse 1 said, are these things so? Now, Stephen had the platform. And he goes from chapter 7, verse 3, 37, 44. How far does he go? He goes all the way to 50. 50 verses of history of Israel and relating to God. What God did, all the beautiful stuff God did. Then he said in 51, you stiff-necked and uncircumcised in heart and ears, you always resist the Holy Spirit. As your fathers did, so do you. So did they kill him? No. He went on. Which of the prophets did your fathers not persecute? And they killed those who foretold the coming of the Just One, of whom you now have become the betrayers and murderers, who have received the law by the direction of angels and have not kept it. Now they reacted to that, right? When they heard these things, they were cut to the heart and they gnashed at him with their teeth. That's all they did. But the straw that broke the camel's back, causing the first martyr to take his place in the long list of martyrs, it says he, in verse 55, being full of the Holy Spirit, gazed into heaven and saw the glory of God and Jesus standing at the right hand of God. But he announced something more powerful than saying Jesus. It says, he said, look, I see the heavens opened and the Son of Man standing at the right hand of God, a place reserved only for God, the throne itself with the seat, and the Lord Jesus as the Son of Man, the only man that never sinned in the flesh. Oh my. It says they cried out with a loud voice, stopped their ears, you know, and they just killed him. They ran at him with one accord, and they cast him out of the city and stoned him. And the witnesses laid down their clothes at the feet of a young man named Saul. That's how Saul got his start in the church. And they stoned Stephen as he was calling on God and saying, Lord Jesus, receive my spirit. Then he knelt down and cried out with a loud voice, Lord, do not charge them with this sin. And when he had said this, he fell asleep. Because when you die as a believer, your flesh dies. Your soul doesn't die. Your spirit doesn't die. No one's does, ever. But the flesh does. And there is a thing called death and second death, which results in separation. Because death really is separation from God. That's what death and sin is, separation from God. But we, as believers in the Lord Jesus Christ, can avail ourselves of the promise that he'll not only never leave us nor forsake us, but that we are accepted in the Beloved as his sons. And we just are so happy and thankful that he rose from the dead. If he hadn't risen from the dead, we wouldn't have hope, and our life would be futile. It says that in 1 Corinthians 15. And if Christ did not rise from the dead, then no one's risen. And we of all men who are most pitiable. But we're not. We are believers. We have his life. Shall we pray? Heavenly Father, we just want to thank you for your Son. Help me use a word like just. able to say he loved us and gave himself for us, even as Paul said, that he did not live, but Christ lived in him, and the life he lives in the flesh, he lived by faith in the Son of God, who loved him and gave himself for him. Mm-hmm. So, Father, we're here today as witnesses. Help us, Lord, to have the boldness to proclaim the fact that your Son conquered sin and rose from the dead because he had no sin in him. And now he lives in the power of an endless life, as it says in Hebrews 7, to ever live to intercede for us. So now we have a risen Savior who's able to do much better than any other priest. He's our great high priest who lives in the power of an endless life. There'll be no interruption in the way he ministers to us by death. He will never die, and we'll never have to learn of a new high priest. He's the one that is fitted for us for eternity, and we him. We just thank you, Father. We look forward to the day when we will have no sin because of the fact that we won't have flesh. But in the meantime, we thank you that you don't see us with any remembrance of sin because your Son paid that debt with his own precious life blood. And he did it by dying and rising and ascending to your right hand even now. So please bless and give us your grace today.